when I left out of Jackson, my baby was standing in her door. Now when I left out of Jackson, I rode that M&O.
Sonny Boy Williamson was born into the Jim Crow South, marked by racial separation and hatred, and came of age during the desperation of the Great Depression. From his hard scrabble childhood to his tragic end, Sonny Boy Williamson was born into the blues, and he became the first great virtuoso of the humble mouth harp. But only the most devoted fans of the blues still remember this formative musician today.
I can't do no good up here. I've gotten the genius on me.
John Lee Curtis Williamson came into the world on March 30th, 1914, near the West Tennessee cotton mill town of Bemis, now part of Jackson, Tennessee. His mother was Nancy Utley, only recently married to Ray Williamson. While she was pregnant, Ray died after playing ball one August afternoon and drinking too much cold lemonade too quickly. John Lee's relatives were simple subsistence farmers, and he spent his childhood milking cows and chopping cotton with his younger half-brother. He seemed to have little future beyond that until, at the age of 11, he received a harmonica for Christmas, a gift from his mother. From that point on, in between chores, John Lee taught himself to play the little mouth harp by listening to old records on a wind-up gramophone. The pocket-sized harmonica lent itself to the hoboing lifestyle, and by the time he was 16, John Lee could be heard across West Tennessee and Arkansas, jamming with blues greats like Sleepy John Estes. The music scene in Jackson centered upon Shannon Street on the west end of downtown, which, along with other Jackson landmarks, plays a prominent role in a number of John Lee's more than 120 recordings. He also played with the Four Lambs, a gospel quartet, at Blair's Chapel CME Church. These pictures are of the rebuilt church, some 2 miles from its original location. Trips to Memphis and St. Louis, where an uncle lived, helped John Lee hone his skills. As well, his music gave him a voice. For all of his life, he struggled with a painful stammer, a speech impediment he eventually incorporated into his signature slurred singing style. In the late 1920s to early 30s, John Lee frequented Memphis, where W.C. Handy and Beale Street had given birth to the blues. There he played with established bluesmen like Big Joe Williams, known for using a 9-string guitar. For years afterward, he continued to team with Williams on many of his recordings. In the River City, John Lee picked up the styles of other harp players and shaped his own style into the blues harp sound that dominated in the 1950s. He also picked up the nickname Sonny Boy. Though the harmonica had been considered only a child's toy or an instrument for producing sound effects, Sonny Boy used his country blues style to mold it into a lead instrument, and he became the first prominent harmonica player to write his own tunes. But before the blues harmonica would coalesce into the rollicking, crying wail Sonny Boy would pioneer, he would have to leave West Tennessee. He would have to follow the Mississippi River north to Chicago. Chicago was already home to established blues players like Big Bill Brunzi, Blind John Davis, Yank Rachel, and Big Maceo. Sonny Boy arrived in 1934 and immediately began to play in what were called black and tan clubs, night spots for minority clientele, located mostly on Maxwell Street. By 1937, he had begun his recording career, beginning with Good Morning Schoolgirl, recorded on May 5th at the Leland Hotel in Aurora, Illinois, for the RCA Bluebird label. Good Morning Schoolgirl has been covered by many musicians over the years, including the likes of the Yardbirds and the Grateful Dead. Gradually, Sonny Boy cast aside the country flavor of his sound in favor of a more up-tempo, exhilarating style. He developed a sound using choked notes and cross-harp playing, a short-tongued delivery, combined with the rhythmic subtlety of his rural background. While he drew on the work of Noah Lewis and Hammy Nixon, his phrasing was unique, making his heart bark and moan. He almost always played in cross-note tuning, in which the harmonica is four steps higher than the accompanying music. This style required more drawn notes than blown, which facilitated his vocals, and also promoted the slurring and bending of notes peculiar to harp playing. Into this technique, he poured the soul of his poor West Tennessee upbringing. As well, he eventually made his sound thoroughly modern through amplification. At times, his tempo was so powerful during recording sessions, he had to put a pillow under his feet to muffle the tapping. The sound came to be known as the Bluebird Beat. Quickly, other harp players picked up his style, spreading his popularity, and he toured extensively, playing particularly often in Detroit. But Sonny Boy didn't forget his roots deep in West Tennessee, and made one return trip to Jackson in November of 1937 to claim Lacey Bell Davidson as his bride. The couple returned to Chicago, where Sonny Boy continued his writing and recording with RCA Bluebird, and Lacey Bell's name found its way into many of his songs.
Lacey tells me, Papa, Papa, well, you ain't no good at all.